Welcome. This is an intro to CocosSharp. No previous CocosSharp experience or game development experience is assumed here. And even the C# code, I've kept it real simple. And I have a new example to show some people. So let's get started. So there's lots of options for building games with CocosSharp. Building games with Xamarin and with C#. You have Monogame, which probably most people have heard of, is an open source implementation of XNA that's quite popular, works on a variety of different platforms, and is actually what CocosSharp builds upon and uses under the covers. Another option you'd have is Mono for Unreal Engine, something we just recently announced. It brings C# bindings and tooling on top of the Unreal Engine, which otherwise would be C++. So that's another option people have, kind of professional engine at the high end of the game spectrum. You can make, you know, the quote-unquote AAA kind of games if you have the skills and resources to do that. So kind of complex, but you can do some pretty amazing things. Certainly not easy, though. Then there's SpriteCat, which is great. It's a 2D game engine from Apple and works on Apple's platforms. You can do 2D games on iOS, and you can do 2D games on the Mac. It's actually inspired by the Cocos2D. Inspired is the best word I could come up with. They clearly looked at Cocos2D, which is the Objective-C implementation is what they looked at. Cocos2D is a 2D game engine that has a lot of different flavors, a lot of different ports of it. And Apple has SpriteKit. And SpriteKit is not Cocos2D, but it's great. Only downside of SpriteKit, really, is that you're in Apple's platforms. You won't be able to put a game on Android with SpriteKit, for example, or on any Windows platform, or anywhere else that's not Apple. But it is pretty great, you know, if you're happy with staying in Apple's ecosystem, and we of course support all native things from Apple. And in the same breath, there's another framework that Apple has that they've had for a couple of years that they just recently brought to iOS this last year, last release, called SceneKit. And SceneKit's fantastic. It's a 3D API. It's a high-level 3D API. Brings a scene graph API to iOS and to Mac. It started on Mac and is now on iOS. And you can blend SceneKit apps and games with SpriteKit. So again, we bring that to C#. I'd encourage people to check out my Evolve talk, which is available in the Evolve videos. I do an intro to SceneKit. And again, it's great. It's very impressive implementation of a scene graph. It's Apple only, though, so you're not going to be able to go to multiple platforms. Also 3D, so really cool, totally respected, and it's a tremendous API. But again, you're in Apple's world with that, okay? But again, you can use it from C# and use it from Xamarin. But what we're going to talk about here today is a game engine and a framework called CocosSharp. When I mentioned Cocos2D a second ago, Cocos2D is an implementation of Cocos2D. The popular one is in Objective-C on Apple's platforms. That's where it got real popular. It originally started out as a Python API. That still exists. I ported it or built it. A version of it in Objective-C and got real popular as iOS emerged. There's also an implementation in C++ that allows you to go cross-platform, but then you have to write in C++. There's a HTML implementation. There's a lot of flavors of Cocos2D. And we have a really great one that's open source called CocosSharp, and we're going to talk about it and introduce you to it here today. So mentioned there, CocosSharp is open source. Well, that's pretty great. It's also cross-platform. The cross-platformness of it comes from the fact that it builds on Monogame. And so therefore it can target all the platforms that Monogame targets. We actually say that it supports a subset of that because we're just targeting the popular ones. But if you wanted to say go to Linux with it, just a little bit of work, you could actually make it work on Linux. But as far as project templates and samples, documentation, things such as that, generally targeting the mobile platforms and certain desktops, such as Windows and Apple. So here's a screenshot you can see of a game I have called Gone Bananas. If you want to see Gone Bananas, I'll show you where you can get it. And they did, again, talk on CocosSharp. That was an earlier version of this one at Evolve. If you haven't seen that already, you could check it out. But this one has some newer information and have a new sample to show folks at the end. So even for folks that have seen it before, you'll have a few new things here to see. All right, so let's get into CocosSharp. What makes up a CocosSharp game? Well, there's different parts of the API. There's an application, which we're going to talk about. It's the thing that sets up the game and starts it. There's scenes. You can think of the scene kind of like the metaphor of a movie, where you have a movie and the movie has a scene in it. There's actually something called a director, and the director manages the movie between scenes. But the scenes are kind of for the most part, they're the levels of the game. You can think of them that way. Like you see this sample we have called Angry Ninjas. It's an Angry Birds kind of clone. That would be a scene that you're seeing there. One scene, the game scene in Angry Ninjas. And there could be multiple screens in a scene for each one. The things that actually go on the screen start their life from a thing called a layer. Right? And so a scene has a layer, and the layer is where you're going to build up all the visuals and everything that goes into a particular level of the game. Sprites are the images that can be put onto a layer, right? You can build up a hierarchy of these sprites. They're actually a base class called a node. We'll talk more about that. And then there's these things called actions. Actions are where CocosSharp gets really interesting, and it gets maybe more interesting than, not interesting, but a little easier to use, or has some additional functionality versus certain other game engines. Of course, a lot of the engines have this. These are little, for the most part, commands. They're classes. But they're these little things, you know, that you can use in code to do stuff, such as jump, move, so you can declaratively, so to speak, script your game in a way. Right? So they're very powerful, makes the code very high level and declarative in nature, so very easy to program against. And there's a lot more. There's particle systems, there's an audio engine built into it, makes it super easy to add audio effects, background audio and effects. There's a couple different flavors of physics APIs, all kinds of cool stuff. So let's get into this API and talk about it. So first thing you have when you're dealing with a CocosSharp game, you're building a CocosSharp game, is you have this class called the CC application. That's the application I spoke of. This is the non-cross-platform part of your game. It's just a little bit of code to bootstrap the game. So you create a CC application, you create a thing called, you assign its app delegate class, a property to an instance of an app delegate. It's a lot like the app delegate in iOS, but it's cross-platform. And then you start the game. So this code would go, the code I'm showing there, that snippet, would go in the iOS application in this particular case. You'd have a similar kind of code with one additional line that would be platform-specific that would go in an Android application. And then you'd have the application and implementation to start the game and a Windows application and so on. So just a little bit of code to bootstrap things using the application. The application class itself is cross-platform, but you write this code in a platform-specific spot. Right? Then you fall into the world, this app delegate, where life begins in CocosSharp, really, and everything's cross-platform and it can go into shared code. So that class is called a CC application delegate. And the application delegate, it's modeled after, because this thing was, you know, came originally, there was this Objective-C API and the iPhone. They had the idea of an app delegate. And we took that forward into CocosSharp here, even though it's cross-platform. But it'll look a lot like a UI application delegate to folks that are familiar with iOS. If you're not already familiar with iOS, it's really simple. This is just you get a few methods to manage life cycle throughout the game. And again, it's totally cross-platform, so it could be in shared code. And you set up some initialization stuff in here, such as you're going to have resources, and the resources get put in a content folder. This is where you tell the game, you tell CocosSharp about where the content lives. It's also where the main window of the very first scene gets loaded up internally. So this is the life cycle that you deal with in an application delegate. It's just, again, it's exactly, totally familiar, again, to somebody who's done some iOS development, but it's just things are going to happen as the app goes into the background, comes to the foreground, and finishes launching, so on. So you get a few methods that you can override to do things, such as, for example, if you were playing background audio, the application went into the background, you don't want to keep the audio playing, so you can pause that background audio and then bring it back when the application comes back into the foreground. That would be an example of something you would do in an app delegate. Okay. Now, I mentioned that one of the things, there's some initialization stuff you do inside your app delegate implementation. One of the things you're going to have to set in there is this content folder. And the content is just what you might think it is. It's the images that you have that are going to be loaded into the sprites, as sprites. It's sounds that you use. It's animations that you may have. Animations being you might have an image that packs a bunch of frame-based images that you're going to load to do frame-based animation, which you can do. Particle systems, you could have third-party particle designers use that could bring in a custom particle system, so you can load those files, you can save those files in there and load them. So all this kind of stuff, fonts, would go into your content. And then, so what you have to do is in the application delegate, it's going to get passed in the application, and that's the instance of the CC application. You just set where the folder is in your solution, and you could give it a name by conventions, typically called content. And then you just have any subfolders that go underneath there, you could add search paths to them. So if I have a sounds folder where I keep my sounds, I just on the application, there's a content search path that I could add the subfolders. There is some, I'm going to talk a little bit about handling different size resources, and you could use this now with the newer API, with the new property that we have to deal with, you know, if you wanted to have images that are loaded on high definition or low definition. We'll get to that a little later in the talk here. But going forward, once you have your inside your application, you want to now load up something on the screen. And you'll recall a few minutes ago I said that there's these scenes, and the scenes are basically the place where you're kind of managing each layer, each screen. It's not anything visual about it. It's just managing all the visuals that are appearing on this particular portion of the game. Think of it like the level in game speak, right? So there's a class called a director, again, kind of following the metaphor of a movie or a TV show and a director. And a director replaces the scene, right? It says, hey, scene, this is the new scene that needs to get loaded. And what you do is you just call it replace scene, or there's some transition calls. And in this example, for you can see here, it hangs off the window. So there's a window default directory. You just call replace scene, and you replace it with a particular implementation of a scene. In this case, I'm going to go from the start scene to the game layer scene, and then so I can get the game loads. And that would cause this to load up, in this case, Gone Bananas, where I have the that Gone Bananas game layer scene with its subsequent layer called the game layer. So the scene's managing various portions of the game. Again, it's just the levels of the game, and they contain the layers. That's the big part you have to know. You have a director. The director's transitioning scenes and loading scenes and managing scenes, and you have a scene that contains layers, right? And that's basically the gist of it. The scene is managing the logic for the particular layers that it contains, right? And there's a second scene that gets loaded. So now the layers themselves are where the visual things start coming into play. So you have this scene, and the scene is going to contain a layer, right? And by the scene having that layer, you can start building up the UI of this particular part of the game in a hierarchy. It's just a node tree. The base class is called a CC node, and then there's those things, CC nodes get added into this hierarchy of CC nodes. For example, one type of CC node, the one you'll use the most, would be a CC sprite. Right. There could be others, though, too. There's menus, there's labels, like I have on the screen here with that little the text there. This is tap the screen, go bananas. So that's in the simplest example, that would be, you know, what Hello World would look like. But you could have all kinds of complexity. And then all these things can get added into this screen, and you'd have a game layer. Right? It's also scheduling that you can do in a layer. So you can do things in sort of an event-driven fashion. Not sort of. You can do things in an event-driven fashion, which is a little scary. You can, if you've done any kind of game development, because that could have lag and could have performance implications if you need things to happen every time through the run loop. You could also do schedulers that could say run this particular block of code at some particular delta t, right? Or you can even have update methods that get called on every iteration through the run loop. This allows you to do repeated code. So if, say, every time you're coming through the run, you wanted to check all the collisions or check something across all the nodes in a particular hierarchy, you could do that by scheduling some code. And this is just a very simple schedule method that you could use inside of a layer where you can have game logic to do that. So adding a layer is really easy. It's just you create the scene, you create a layer, and then you just add it as a child by calling scene.addChild. And it's just CC node is the base class. So that's how you're going to add anything in CocosSharp. You're just going to keep calling something that's a CC node addChild. You can just build up hierarchies that get added into the layer. Okay? Now, that's great. You can have the scene management. You can have layers. You can have scheduling. And it's easy to add things onto the screen. But to make the game interesting, you actually have to have, depending on what you're building, if you're not building a word game or something, you want to have these visual images that can be, loaded for you automatically onto the GPU, and you don't want to have to handle the internals of OpenGL or if it was DirectX if you're on a Windows platform. And what CC Sprite's doing for you, it's doing that. It's allowing you to put images, resources, into your game and not have to worry about decompressing them and loading them onto the GPU, drawing them, animating them independent of other images. A sprite extracts a texture. Underneath is a class called a CC texture that you can't actually get out of it. Usually you just have to deal with CC sprite. It abstracts a texture, And those textures can be moved independently and subsequently animated independently, interacted with independently, scaled independently, and so on, transformed. Right? So that's where you're going to build up your what you're seeing in the game. You can see in the Gone Bananas, I had a background texture, or excuse me, background image. That was one sprite. I have some clouds I put on. I had some circles that are basically like little balls. And then I have these little monkeys that I have in there and a banana. Usually what you would do, you can load loose images, and it's fine when you're building up a game and you're developing it. It's very convenient, but it's also inefficient. So what people commonly do is they'll put all the images into one image using some kind of texture packing tool. You'll hear them termed either texture atlases or sprite sheets. They mean the same thing. And then you have, what it is you have all the images in one image, right? And then based on the location of the particular image, such as the banana or each particular monkey that's going to be used to animate the monkey as he moves around and make him look like he's running, it'll pull out the, based on the coordinates, the section of the image that has that particular image. And it's keyed, so you don't have to do the work to figure out where in the sprite sheet, where in the texture atlas the particular image is. You just, the texture atlas tools, and there's several of them you could use to generate a texture atlas, would usually give you some metadata file that would go with it. And a metadata file could be used by you know, it has some kind of a key that you can go in and say, hey, give me the banana image, or give me the fourth monkey image, or give me all the monkey images, and so on. And you can even use things like link to then iterate across them, so it's really, really convenient. All right. Now, in CocosSharp 1.21, which we just released, we just introduced a new property. It's called default pixel to content size ratio. So if you take a look back, if anyone has or wants to take a look back at my Evolve talk, which was an older version of this, I mentioned this, and I talked about convention. And then we actually changed the convention. And you know, there was this convention-based naming. You could use like the at NX, at 2X. And you could, just like on iOS, you could look at high-definition resources. I think that still works, too. But what you can do that's a lot better as you go across different. Now, that's great if you're just dealing with iOS, but what if you go to Android and it's all these different resolutions? Well, you can have all the resolutions you want. Now, if you would just load it by default, load a particular image by default, the content size is going to be the content size of the default image. So if you want a higher resolution you had multiple images, and you had one image that was higher resolution one and one that was a lower resolution one, and you wanted to go to the higher resolution one, the default content size would be twice as much. So you can use this ratio to, based on the resolutions that you're loading things into, to load up different images. So you can use that. What you can do is you can say take the search paths that we have, and you can have different folders, say high definition, low definition, whatever definition. And you can have different resources at different resolutions. And then this ratio will allow you to maintain a consistent content size independent of what the resolution is. So it's a really smart way to go about it. If you were to go and make, using our project templates, and make a new CocosSharp game, the showcase template that you can get with the CocosSharp project templates to make a new CocosSharp game will automatically add some simple code that shows how to use this. And there's the content size ratio that you can set it to a float, and then there's the plural form of the ratios, which allows you to set it to a CC size if you wanted to have the ratios be different in the horizontal or vertical directions. Okay? And the big point there, big takeaway, is that you can use multiple resolutions for multiple resources for different resolutions and maintain content size across those resolutions. So it's pretty straightforward, pretty clean. Now, CC sprite batch. I mentioned a second ago or a moment ago that you can load images independently. And that's really convenient if you're just developing the game and you just want to get an image or make some developer art that you're going to replace later with art from your an artist that you may work with. Now, the thing is, it's also inefficient because underneath the covers, it's going to do a bind call. It's inefficient with how it interacts with the GPU under the covers. Actually, in simpler games, though, it's still works just fine, so don't over-optimize. But what CC Sprite Batches does for you, it allows you to put all the sprites into a sprite batch and then get all the rendering in one step. So it's more efficient interaction with the GPU underneath. Now that said, I just want to make a note that you, it's great and it'll give you a big performance win. I heard that we may be going away from this in a future version, or it'll still be there, but it'll be handled for you, so you can just work straight with CC sprites and it'll just figure out how to do it optimally under the covers, and that might be nice. But just, you know, certainly today and even going forward, maybe just know it's there, because it can, if you had a whole bunch of images, you can put them all into a sprite batch. If you're running into some sort of performance problem, this is one thing to take a look at that could improve your performance. Even if it goes away in the future, hopefully then it would just be optimized when you have to think about it. All right, so that's kind of cool or important to know about as well. Now, that's great. So you have scenes. The scenes have layers. The layers can manage game logic and can also have all the things that you're putting on the screen. But everything's static at that point, right? You could use the director to move between scenes, but nothing's happening in the game. You could, and sometimes you might want to, if you want to take lower level control and know exactly when it's happening on a time basis, update and put game logic going each time through the game loop, right? Such as on update or in schedulers. And for some cases, you need to do that, right? If you're managing collisions across all different nodes, something like collisions would be a good thing to do that with. Now, however, if you want to just do stuff that seems almost event-driven in a way, but you're thinking it's a game, I don't want to do events, but I just want to make the monkey bounce or jump or run or move, balls animate, you can do that with these things called actions. And what actions are is they're just little pieces of code, little classes that perform specific tasks on nodes. Nodes are sprites. Nodes can be sprites that can have other children, and so that's a way that you can group an action and make a whole bunch of sprites all move together. Things such as that. So you can run them sequentially, kind of a composite pattern through a thing called the CC sequence, and the CC sequence can contain other actions. By putting them in a CC sequence, you would then run the sequence on a node, such as a sprite, and then all the actions would go one after another. You could use another action called the CC spawn to group a bunch of actions to run in parallel. And then there's independent actions that you could do, such as the move to. There's usually the movement ones have a move to, move by, jump to, jump by, things such as that. So what this does, over and above everything else, I think Cocos 2D and our implementation, CocosSharp, the implementation of actions in this framework is what really makes it easy, and I think what really makes it a powerful framework to use, in my opinion, if you're just getting started with doing simple games, especially 2D games. Certainly there's other game engines that have, you know, this concept. It's not, you know, it wasn't created here. However, it's implemented nicely here. And it makes it very easy to, you know, I'll use the word again that I used earlier, declaratively, you know, almost like scripting your code. You'll see this if you were to go look at SpriteKit. SpriteKit has the same concept, right? There's other game engines that have it. So this is a big win, and this is where it makes it really easy to put games together with CocosSharp, I think. Right? So definitely, you know, we're going to take a look at how to use those here as an example we're going to get to. So going forward, though, great. Now you have the... I've shown you now there's what you would do to move stuff around or animate, you know, create things happening in the screen. But we haven't talked about interaction. So there's different ways to interact with things. There's accelerometers, joysticks, and then this obviously on mobile devices, there's touch interaction. The API to interact with all the things I just mentioned, very similar. Just add these event listeners for the particular kind of thing you're dealing with, such as touch. What you have to deal with touch is a class called the CC touch. CC touch encapsulates a touch on the screen, a lot like what you may have looked at in other APIs, certainly like UI touch and iOS, but again, cross-platform. There's methods to deal with all the touches happening at once, and there's methods to deal with one-by-one touch. So if I wanted to deal with three touches and get multi-touch, I could do the ones to deal with touches begin, and I'd get all the touches passed in. Right? If I just want to get... Not have multi-touch, but ignore that you're having multi-touch, which I'm going to do in the game I'm going to show you, and just have the first touch taken out. I could just take the first one out of the group that gets passed in. Or if I want to handle the first touch and then the second touch and then the third touch independently, is a similar event handling, but you can just do targeted touch one by one. Like touch, there's also accelerometer support. There's other kinds of input as well. These are the two kind of big ones you would deal with. That's available in the CC accelerometer class that hangs off of a window accelerometer property. And the code to do that is a lot like touch. You have another kind of event listener. All of these things, they're in CC event listener or something. So in this one, CC event listener accelerometer, you hand it a method, and then you just add that event listener to the layer. And then I just have that method that I implement my event handling. Just like I would implement methods to deal with touch, I would have an acceleration method You can call it whatever you want. I called it the accelerate in the snippet here. But it's just whatever you set to on accelerate, and you just get the acceleration in any of the three directions. And that's how you can do the doodle jump type of games where, you know, users moving the phone back and forth and you want to maybe make something move. Okay, so very simple. You know, the way you interact with it, the way you write the code is similar in way to what you would do with touch or any of the kinds of input that you would deal with here. Touch and acceleration being the two we talk about today here. And those are the big ones to deal with, of course, on mobile. And we also have audio. Right? So at that point, you can make a simple game with what I even just showed you, because you have the scene loading. You know, the director manages loading the scenes and transitioning scenes. Scenes have layers. Layers can have game logic, and then they can build up the UI. Actions can script what's happening, along with schedulers. And then you have content handling, you know, to put images in. So good. You could do a simple game with that, and I'm going to show you a simple game that we're going to build here. But if you want to like have, you know, interactions such as when something explodes or any kind of sound effects, and it's really easy. There's a C# port of an API called CocosSharp that we have. You just get at it through simple audio engine, shared engine, and you can do two types of things very easily with it. You can make sound effects, such as something exploding, or you can play background music that's always running. You can actually have a sound effect automatic loop just by setting a Boolean property when you create it, and I'm going to do that here. You can do either one, so it's like just a couple lines of code to add either. Very, very easy to deal with. You know, simple audio use cases in here, just a couple lines of code. So that's great, right? So now we talked about, like, you know, all the kind of pieces to build up a game that you could add audio. There's more than just doing images and doing everything from sprites. There's these things we have called primitives. And I'll just take a side note. If you were to use something like CocosSharp to go outside of a game, haven't done it yet, but I'm actually working on something to do this. So you wanted to make a visualization engine to do, I don't want to even just say charts, but maybe animated charts, infographics. We have a cross-platform, you know, simple but very, very nice cross-platform graphics API in here that you can then, these are just nodes, so they can be animated and transformed with actions just like anything else. So you can have a CC draw node, and you can draw all kinds of primitives like the ones you see on the screen. And it's real easy to do. So you have the CC draw node, and then you just have various draw methods. And, you know, it's different based on what you're drawing, and you can do anything with the polygon one. That's why I picked this example to show. And you can just set some colors, and I can draw this, and I can, it's a node. I add it to the hierarchy just like I do with the sprites. Then I can animate it just like I do with the sprites. It's actually a good for two things. One, it's good because you could do a visualization or something that doesn't depend upon having the images a priori. That's kind of nice because it reduces the size of the game down. Of course, it's like, you know, it'd be hard to do it all in code. If it was a complex thing, you could see it would start getting unruly if you didn't have a tool to do it. But it's quite nice if you like had some API that already had a bunch of polygons already cooked for you. It would be kind of cool. That's one of the things I was saying I'm sort of working on the side that I'm going to hopefully bring to people soon. But it's in addition to getting the size down, it's also nice that if you didn't have assets, you could script, you could start putting your game together, use primitives, and then just replace them later with some artist's art. Or some art you could get online from like a commercial or, you know, open, there's all kinds of art sites online you can get art from, right? So it's a good way to start putting it into the game if you're a programmer, not much of an artist like I am, okay? So primitives are really cool. There's also very cool, and where with very little effort, you could build really cool looking games and really cool visualizations and effects in your game with these things called particle systems. If anyone knows about graphics APIs, you know, if using OpenGL or DirectX directly, excuse me, you may have heard of something called shaders, and you can do all kinds of powerful things with shaders, but they're a little harder to work with. Certainly not trivial. And introducing particle systems, if you out of the box, there's a whole bunch of particle systems, such as the galaxy smoke. So you just write a couple lines of code, and you can get a really cool effect. And if you go to a third-party tool, and there's several I could recommend some, but beyond that, there's several easy to find. You can design a particle system, and CocosSharp has really good support for bringing those in. So here's the code to put a sun particle. It's one of the ones that comes out of the box. You can just create a CC sun particle. It's available in the Gone Bananas tutorial that I have. I just add a couple colors, the start and end color, and you can get a cool, you know, sun that gets added. There's a bunch of others. Like I said, there's Explode, there's the Galaxy, there's some one that looks like fireworks. all kinds of particle systems out of the box. And there's more, though. If you, as I mentioned, go to a third-party tool, this one here I like, one I like, but if there's others, I could recommend, I could find some to recommend to people if you're interested. I really like this one. It's called Particle Designer. It's a commercial tool. It's not free, but it's really great, and it allows you to do some really interesting particle system designs, really nice editor. And then bringing them into, it has great export support for all different frameworks, because you know these people made this tool to work in, you know, for anybody really, and it works great with CocosSharp. I could, to use it with CocosSharp, I could export a plist, use the thing cross-platform via the class in CocosSharp called the CC Particle System Quad, and look, all I have to do, all I have to do is just create the CC Particle System Quad, bring in the file that's exported out of the tool, it has everything all into the file, the plist file, resources and all. Just then, just like it, the particle system is just another node. Add it to the scene, just like anything else. And then the particles, of course, can animate themselves, and it's pretty great. So you can get a lot of functionality out of particle systems for very little. Almost seems for free, not free cost wise, but free from the amount of work. So that's pretty amazing. I encourage people to check out particle systems. There's also parallax support in CocosSharp. Now, this is the parallax support that if you were going to do something like Angry Birds, where you just kind of go back and forth and you wanted to move things, move sprites really, that are in the scene graph, in the layers at different speeds, you can kind of give the illusion or the feeling of depth. Angry Birds is a good example of what you get through this node called the CC Parallax node. So what you do is you add, like I have the clouds here, you see when the monkey goes up and down? I'm moving the clouds in the Y direction, and they move at different, you know, see they move at a different speed. Usually you use it with backgrounds. But what you can do is you add the images, or your sprites, into the nodes really, right? You could do it with primitives too, but you know, I'm doing it with sprites. You add the nodes into the parallax node, you set some ratios, and then you actually move the parallax node, and everything that's within the parallax node will move. It will handle moving everything relative to each other at the you know the right relative motion, and you can get this sort of parallax effect. Now, this isn't if you're going to do an infinite scroller, because people immediately think of that. This isn't what you would use that for. This is just to kind of go back and forth. If you wanted to do an infinite scroller, you would have to roll something like that yourself. There's nothing out of the box. It's actually maybe I'll write a blog post. It's actually really easy to do. But this is exactly what you would do. You know, moving the background back and forth as you would go from like one side of a game to another. Something like an Angry Birds would be an example. Or just maybe it doesn't have to be a background, like I show here, with moving the clouds. So CC Parallax Node, really easy to add a little parallax support, give a little feeling of depth to a 2D game. Now, actions are really great, as I mentioned. You can tell I think that's probably the biggest, one of the biggest things you get from using CocosSharp, other than obviously it's cross-platform, C#, it's all great. There's also these things called effects. So you get particle systems, you get actions to kind of script your game within your game logic. Well, it's not really scripting, but I mean, adding your game logic very declaratively high level. You have particle systems to add effects, but they're actually effects implemented as actions, which you can apply right out of the box as well. Such as in the example here, which is taken right out. I just tweaked right out of the project template. I have a couple of images there. You ignore the particle system. That's just the came with the project template. I have this fade in and the waves. That comes right out of the project template too. And just changing the resources, you can see we have the little image of the robot there, and there's that other one. My son actually made the images. So give him a shout out. So there's you know, they give that wavy effect just with a couple lines of code. You can fade them in, you can wave them, you can spiral them. You can add some really cool effects by these really out-of-the-box actions that you have, which were terming effects. There's 3D, there's shuffling, you can split images and have them move around like a puzzle that would be broken up into a bunch of pieces and then animate all the pieces. If you check out the tests that are in the CocosSharp repo, there's a whole, all of the effects, or most of the effects are shown in there, so you can pull the snippets out of there and pull them into your code. Really easy to work with and implement and use in actions. So that's kind of neat because you can then just, you know, put them right in the middle of your other game logic and assign them to nodes. There's a couple different physics APIs as well. You don't have to build a game with physics, right? The Gone Bananas tutorial uses the Box2D C# port. That's what I'm showing here. There's a test for Box2D. Also developing is an implementation of Chipmunk Sharp. another 2D physics engine, rigid body physics engines. So this is where you can add, you know, physics. 2D rigid body physics do things like simple rope physics or swinging something on a pendulum. It's good for getting collisions, balancing things, stuff like that. You don't get soft body physics where things compress when they collide. Although if people are interested in that, I could point you to some other resources and maybe some ways we could get that into CocosSharp. But you get rigid body physics and, you know, the kind of thing you see and is used in Angry Birds. Box2D is actually a real popular 2D physics engine. It's used in Angry Birds and, you know, used outside of the Cocos, which obviously isn't Cocos2D, is used outside of the Cocos2D world. You could use it very easily in C-sharp with CocosSharp, and you could also use this Chipmunk Sharp one as well. Bunch of tests for the Box2D one. That's why I used it in our test repo as well. Okay, and you can check out GOM bananas. I've got an example of how to use it in there, and some helper code that makes it a little easier to work with. So that's kind of a whirlwind tour over the API, and that's what I want to do now. Is get out of slides. Just wanted to kind of give people all the terms. You can see everything that's kind of used in building a game. I have this. I'm just going to comment these things out here. I'm just going to take a second. Give me a second here. We're just going to comment a couple things out. I'm going to build this little game up step by step. I was testing it before. I forgot to recomment anything, so sorry about that. So let me just show you this little game here with all the stuff I just turned off, and just make sure everything runs. I'm just going to run the iOS one. I've got in the code you'll get, I also did the Android version as well, which was no big achievement. It was just 4 lines of code. If you're interested, I'll also put this game afterwards that we're going to build here on line. I'll add a Windows Phone one as well, so it's very easy to add. Because again, the way I'm doing it is I'll share code. So just I got a black screen here. I'm running in the big giant, you know, it almost feels like it's this big sometimes, but you know, the iPhone 6 Plus emulator, and just kind of with the size kind of expanded so we can see it. Alright, so let's start building up the game and we'll see what we're gonna do. So the first thing I want to do is take a step back from the class I have. I just want to show you that I already did, just to not hide anything, I did pre-cook a little bit of the setup code in that app delegate. I'm not going to do anything with sprites here today. I'm just working with primitives. We could add sprites in. We could look at GOM bananas or some of our other examples to work with adding sprites to just other nodes. Here I'm just going to do it with primitives because it made it easier to, you know, just kind of start building up a simple game. And this one's real simple. It's even easier than GOM bananas. So I think we can kind of get through just walking through the whole thing here in the short time we have. But here's the app delegate. Here's the simplest implementation of one. We just have a little bit of setup code to deal with the places where the content lives. I'm not dealing with, I didn't have to set anything for where my images are going because I didn't have any images in this game, but that's where I could start getting into that new pixel ratio and loading up the proper place for resources based on whether I'm on a high def or low def screen. If I want to do that, if I indeed want to have different resources, I'm creating my scene in here in the app delegate when the application's finished launching, when the game's, you know, just starting up. I'm going to create a game layer. I'm going to add the game layer to the scene, right? And then I'm going to, you know, do a couple things to preload some audio effects I'm going to add in later so that they can be ready to go on the on the audio card that's internal. And then I'm going to use the underneath the covers, this main window run with scene internally uses the director to load up the first scene. And then if I had multi-screen game, I could use the director in each scene to transition to different scenes, right? So that's what gets that first scene on the screen, this game, this scene here, this CC scene, this window, and then this game layer that I have, right? So that's what's going to get that game layer onto the screen and the scene that contains the game layer. So, okay, great. So that's my setup code, cross-platform code, right? Work in Android. All this is cross-platform, remember I'm showing here? And I will show at the end where the code that isn't cross-platform too, just so you see it. But let's go into this class now. I have this game layer, which is CC layer color. There's different base classes of layer. There's one that can layer color, allows me to set a background color. I didn't even bother. I could have just done CC layer here, actually, as a matter of fact. There's also a gradient one you'll see in the project template if you wanted to have a gradient color in the background. So I could have just done CC layer in this case, actually. But I'm just going to leave it since I had it in there already. And it defaults to the black, so that's why it's black. I could change it if I want. And then I set up a couple things. I have a speed that I'm going to use for ship. I'm going to be building a little ship game here with you today, a little side-scroller space game. Those are really the simplest games to build. I've got a little radius for the shots. That's going to be the little things that the ship fires. There's enemies, which are basically like little asteroids coming across the screen. I just did them as circles, so they're going to be, as you'll see. So I just have a few values, a few constants I have to have for sizing. Then I have a ship that I'm going to have is a little spaceship, and I'll come back in a second to what these two guys are about, the shots and enemies. And last thing I have up in the class variables is I have an action. Actions, in addition to having all the canned things you could do, like move, jump, whatever, you could have arbitrary code. You could just have a function, and that this is what the CC call func n allows it to pass, is the one that passes in the node that that the functions that the action is going to be run on. So I'm just going to have this little function here that I've made, this little action that's going to remove the node from the parent where it's going to be. So it's like allows me to remove it. So it's just general purpose one that I have, and then I create it. Then when the scene, you know, when the layer gets first kind of is about to get put on the screen, it's going to get this added to scene is going to be called on it. And that's where I could have done some of this work in a constructor too. If it didn't, you know, it would, like for example, the first couple lines, it wouldn't matter. But at this point, I know it's already been added to the scene, so it's like ready to go. So this is a good place to, you know, as a matter of practice, to set up everything that's going to be happening initially in this particular layer, right? The first thing I'm going to do is I've created the shots and enemies that I passed over a second ago quickly. What I'm doing with shots and enemies is I could have also just made a list of shots or a list of enemies, but just to show you another way to do it, I've actually created nodes called shots and enemies to manage all the enemies that are in the layer and to manage all the shots that are fired that are added into the layer. And then they have as they're added, there's a children property that I could use to get at them. Now, the difference between doing, I could have done it again with a list or, you know, with a regular data collection class. The reason I did it with, well, in this case, it wouldn't have even really mattered. But the reason to do it with something like this is, say I want, it's now a node though as well. In addition to managing all its children and being able to get at them in a collection-like way through the children property, if I wanted to now take a whole group of nodes, say take all the enemies and make them all go away, or make them all get smaller, transform them all, apply something to that whole piece of the hierarchy, I could do it by just, everything I would run, any actions I would run on shots, actions I would run on enemies, transforms, would apply to from that point on down in the tree. So that's why, that's the bigger reason to do that. Also, it's just a nice, convenient way to manage a collection too in it. So you could, in this case, I could have done it either way. If you go back to Gone Bananas, you'll see them as lists. I might actually change that. I think this is actually a better way in games. I don't see any performance benefit from what I've tried so far, though, but just note that. So that's what we're doing there. And to get those shots, they have no visual anything associated with them. They're just managing children. I still have to add them into the layers hierarchy by just calling add child. Right? That's what I always do. I get the bounds that I'm going to be dealing with just for some sizing here. And then the first thing I'm going to do is call this add stars method here. Let me show you what that's going to do, and then we'll look at the code. So second to run. So what add stars does, you can see it puts these little stars on the screen. See, they're animating and they're flying to the left as you move. So I could, you know, change that to look however I wanted. Let's see how you do that. What I did in this particular case, there would have been many ways to implement that. I did it with a particle system, and I did it with a custom particle system. So I used that tool I have called Particle Designer. But again, you could have used other tools, or I could have then tried to do it with a stock particle system. Probably could have built it. Could have done this with nodes as well, but it's really efficient to do it with particle systems, and certainly efficient from a code perspective. I have the particle system I designed, the stars particle system. I bring it in with a CC particle system quad. I have a little offset, which is kind of a little hack, just because the way I made the particle system, it would have been a little too far from the right edge of the screen. It would have had some space. So rather than going back and having to tweak it, that would have been the proper thing to do. I just moved it a little to the right. Works fine. And then I just add them the stars as a node. Just like any other node onto the hierarchy. You position it, and I add it. And that's how I get the stars. That's all you have to do to get the stars added to the screen, added into the game. So that's great. Just four lines of code to do that. Now, next thing I'm going to need is a space game. I need a ship. So let's add a ship. Run this guy. Uncomment that code. And now I have a ship. Great. Remember, I did it as a primitive. Obviously, I could get an artist, somebody with smart skill, and they can make a nice-looking ship. I just did it as a triangle, and I just drew it with the primitives, and I have a particle system for the little fire that's coming up the back. That was a stock one that I just used out of the box, and I just flipped it on its side. Let me show you how to do that. So you have add stars. Now let's take a look at add ship. Couldn't be any simpler. Create a draw node. That's going to be the triangle. Right? Could draw whatever I want, but I'm just drawing it. It happens to be a triangle. Just give it, have an array of points, which are these CC points. Okay? And I call ship draw polygon, and I have a couple colors. One color for the fill color on it, and one color for the the border color. And that's how I draw a polygon. So now I have this polygon that's been drawn, which I'm calling a ship, right? Which is a CC draw node. Again, it's another node. I add it into the hierarchy. I give it some position to put it on the screen. And that's where I use that bounds to just like center it initially there, off to the left, and on the, a little off of the left edge. And I add it to the hierarchy. That would put it on the screen. The fire that's coming out the back of it, out of the box with CocosSharp, there's a bunch of particle systems. One of them is CC particle fire. You can check out the code for how they're implemented. It's all open source. So I, in this case, I could have made a custom particle system, but we had a fire one that I could use. Also, just wanted to show it to you. It would be vertical up and down the fire, like smoke coming out of a, you know, in a fireplace or something. So I just rotated it so it's sideways, just by applying that to the, you know, the node, and giving it rotation and its scale. I made it a little smaller. Then I add it to the scene graph, right? To the layer hierarchy. And that's how I get the fire on the screen. So that's add ship. And I get a ship with fire coming out the back. Great. Now let's come up here. Let's go to the next part. What I want to do is as the I don't want to have a, in this particular game, I wanted to just fire. So just be constantly firing. So this is where I have that scheduler that I mentioned. You can like schedule code to run. In this case, I'm not there's an option you can pass in the time. The time that comes through if you wanted to check time-based things, if you wanted to do manual movement and create your own vectors and like animate things yourself, you could do that. But in this case, I don't need it. All I wanted the thing to do is run this code to fire a shot every tenth of a second is what I'm doing here. All right, so let's do that and see what that looks like. And then I'll show you the fire method, what that's doing here. So I turn off that scheduler and boom, every tenth of a second, I've got these circles, that's what I did, for firing, and I just have them one after another every 10 seconds, animating across the screen until they come off the screen, and then I get rid of it. I'll show you how that happens. So I have the ship, now I have the stars, and I have fire here. So again, it's called in the scheduler up above, right? And then down below here, I created this thing, again, a draw node, I'm just doing a circle. That's just what I chose to do here, just to keep it simple. This one, I used one of the radius that I set up above. I made it a red shot. I didn't fill it, so it's hollow. Thought it looked a little bit cool. And again, same deal. Add it to the hierarchy. We'll just add child. Now, where I'm adding it, though, is I'm not just going add child off the layer like I did with the ship. Like I did with the ship above. I'm going add child. Oops, sorry there. Made it a little small. I do add child on shots, one of those CC nodes that I'm using to manage all the shots that are on the screen. I could have had list of shots, you know, or list of CC node type of thing too. Again, what's interesting and not so much used in this example, but was what's cool is if I wanted to now take all the shots and make them all turn, get bigger, or move them all somewhere, make them all go away, whatever it may be. I could do that by just operating on the shots node, right? Because it's another node in the hierarchy, and everything, all its children would inherit everything that's done on the top level shots. But even above that, it's a fine way to just manage all the things that are added, right? In this case, shots. And then I just give each shot a position, okay? Initially, I just, you know, just moved it a little to the right of the ship, okay? And centered it a little bit. So that's where the shot's going to get added. So if I didn't do anything other than that, I'd have the shot every tenth of a second, the shot, they would be on top of each other, and I'd just have shots added a little to the right of the ship. The way I move it, this is not the first place we're going to see an action. There's a move to action. Most of the actions have a to and a by flavor. So there's a move to, move by, if you just wanted to do it a delta. In this case, I want to move to, that's how I did it, over a second. I'm going to move it to a point that's all the way to the right of the screen. All right? So that's how I get each, every second another one comes out, and that's how they keep moving all the rights one after another, rapid fire. Okay? And then I'm going to call this run actions down here on the shot. Right? That's where we run actions. We run actions on a node. And I'm going to, you know, run actions is a convenience helper that abstracts having to create a CC sequence. So what that'll do underneath is it runs them in, it'll run a sequence. It'll do the move shot, animate it all the way to the right, and then when it comes at the end of it, it'll remove it. And that remove node action is the one I had created up above, my little helper here, which is just an action that has a function to remove the node. So it'll remove the node that this action was run on, and the node that the action was run on in this case is the shot. Okay, so I'm going to move the shot, animate it, and then when it gets to the end, remove it. So because I don't need it anymore. Inefficient. Eventually, it would degrade performance if you got to like I don't know the number, but eventually you'd have so many things in the scene. So I just remove them when they go off the screen. But that's just couldn't be any simpler to do it. So that's firing. So now we have a ship with rapid fire. I want to move the ship, though. In this case, I just kept it simple. I want to move it up and down. So you can see here, remember I said there's event listeners that you can have, and it's how it's implemented here in CocosSharp for different things, CC event listener, whatever. In this case, I did touch all at once. I'll just also show you CC event listener. There's different ones, right? Miles, touch one by one, touch all at once. So there's all different ones you can do. In this case, I'm just doing all at once. I give it the method that's going to handle it, all right? And then I add events listener. I add event listener to the layer in this case. So every time I touch on the layer, this guy's going to get called on touches began. On touches began, here I'm jumping ahead in the code I didn't show you yet, it's just going to handle the touch. I'm just going to take the first touch out. If I did a single touch, I would have got the first touch and the second touch. I would have, if I did one at a time, then I would have to manage that I don't want the second touch. So it's easier to just take out the first touch. Usually this would be to handle multi-touch, but in this case I just did it. Just pull out the first touch, get its location, and what I'm going to do is move the ship to that location. And I wrote a little helper method to move the ship to the location here, and I did it with an action, right? Let me run it, and I'll come back and explain move ship to you in a sec. So now, with that, everything firing, and I tap anyone in the layer, I can move the guy. And I just move it up and down. That's how I did it. Okay? Pretty simple. The move to, it uses an action, but in order to get smooth animation, I didn't want the thing moving, you know, with a linear timing function. I wanted it to move more natural look. So there's a few different easing actions that control the timing function for you. I have different options of timing function. And the one that I thought looked pretty nice was sign in, sign out. So it'll start animating, and it'll start doing the animation on a sine wave going when it moves, starts, when it begins, and when it ends, and in the middle it'll just accelerate. So it gives a smoother kind of look to the thing. It just doesn't jump right to a, you know, like a square wave and just right to the constant speed. It didn't look very natural. So that's the easing's actually available in CocosSharp as actions as well. So I have the move to actually make it animate to the spot that I've touched over a particular time. How fast I go is based on what a speed that I set as a constant. You know, S equals VT, so you can get the time that you're going to go. So it can go faster or slower. I ease it to make it smooth. And then they're both actions. So then again, I can just run actions on each ship, ease the easing one. In this case, easing encapsulates another action, encapsulates the movement action, and that's the actions whose timing function, whose internal animation is going to get eased. Whose timing function is going to get changed by the particular easing action. But you don't even have to think of it. If you just have an action that you're doing your animation with, in this case, you have an easing to action to control the timing that you wrap that other, the one that's actually doing the animation, right, move ship, and then you just run the easing one on the node that you're moving, the ship in this case, and it goes up and down. Pretty simple. And what's kind of cool is, recall, when I did fire, I created a particle system. When I did add ship, I created a particle system, and I added the particle system as a child of the ship. So when I come down in here and I move the ship, I run the action on the ship. The fire that's coming out the back just moves with it. Right? That's that whole encapsulating part. So there's an actual use of it here in the game. So I don't have to do anything to move the particle system for the fire. I get it for free by adding it appropriately in the hierarchy. All right. So that's movement of the ship. Now what I want to do is I have to have something, and I'm firing, I have to have something to shoot at. Similar kind of code. I've got these enemies, right? Let me run that guy and show you what those are. So I was going to maybe make an image with it and make an asteroid or something coming across, but I figured it'll look lousy if I make it. So let's just make circles. Also consistent with the primitive, also easier to do collision. So I've got the circles now coming. This is a lot like the code I had in Gone Bananas. It's a little simpler, but very similar. I'm just going to come off the right of the screen, and in this case, I'm just going to have it at a constant speed, just for simplicity. And I have all these circles coming out. I did it as a half a second, right? And they're coming across. I don't do anything with the collides yet. I'll show you where I did one collision here in a sec here. So there's add enemy every fifth of a second now, or every 5/10 of a second, every half second. I'm going to go add enemy. So let's see what add enemy looks like. Add enemy, if you've looked at Gone Bananas, it's very similar to what I'm doing there. I'm just running actions to move the enemies across the screen. In this case, the difference here with that In that case, I was had bananas falling and they were rotating. In this case, I'm drawing circles, so it's in a different direction. They're coming in the y direction. I've got a little, you know, nothing exciting here, just a little random function to put them at random y locations. Add them to the enemies. That's a little different from what I did in Gone Bananas. Again, so I just wanted to not use a list there, just to show people that, you know, you have that encapsulation, you know, that kind of hierarchical management of resources, and or sprites nodes. Nodes in this case, and I'm adding the enemies in here. Then what I do is I just run the action on the enemies to move them across the screen, and the same remove that I have up above, because it's just going to be whatever node that it's run on, I'm going to run it on the enemy. So create the enemy, which is just a node, draw the circle, position it, add it. It's on the screen at that point. Move it. It's going to move it from right to left. When it gets off the screen, which is going to happen at the end of the movement, it'll just call the remove, and the remove will remove it via that helper, just like I did with the shot up on the top. Okay, and it knows about the node, because that's the node that it was called on. In this case, the enemy, previously the shot. So now I've got enemies coming across. How do I be nice if I could shoot those enemies? So that's what I'm doing. Another scheduler I did here. Yeah, I'm doing different schedulers, just doing it at different times. Seems to work well. I've got this check enemy collisions. Run that guy. So now, this is going to run every iteration through the game loop, right? So now, I don't know if, hopefully you guys can hear the sound. I'm not sure if it's coming through on GoToMeet, but there's an explosion sound happening. Hopefully you're hearing that. And I see this when it hits the... Okay, we'll stop that there. So every time the shot hits the circle, you know, the enemy now, they intersect, they collide. I remove the circle, right, the enemy circle. And what I do is I add a particle system as well to make that cool effect and play an audio effect. And I do that all in this check enemy collisions. Now, you know, the Link fans in the audience will notice it's like I'm committing a sin. I've got like a nested for each. But just I just try to keep it simple and clean to read. You can change. You can do this with Link. It'll be a little more concise. In the event, though, what I'm doing, though, is this is where I'm instead of going to give me the list of all the enemies on the screen, give me a list of all the shots on the screen. Remember, I added the enemies and shots again as children of those other nodes that are in the scene, so I can get at them through the children and do the exact same type of operations on them. So for all the shots and all the enemies on the screen, I'm looking to see if they collide. There's a nice helper function on CC point that I can get the distance between these guys, right? So I can get the distance between every shot and enemy, and I can then just do a little equation of circle. I can just do a little check to see if, based on the radius of the two, if the distance between them is less than or equal to the sum of the radii, then I know I got a hit, right? And if I've got a hit, what do? I can use that helper again. I don't need the helper, actually. In this case, I can just call remove enemy from the parent. That's going to make the circle go away. I play my sound effect, which is an explosion sound effect that I made, and I create another particle system, another custom one that I made in that tool I like, Particle Designer. Could have done any particle system I want, though. Could use a stock one and add the particle system to the screen. And this particular particle system gives me that nice effect that it looks like it implodes and then it disappears at the end of some time slice. And I do that all within the particle, and then there's no particles left. All right? So now I got a pretty simple little game, but it's like I put it together just a few lines of code, like 150 or so lines of code, right? The last thing I want to do is I got these lasers. They're just kind of boring. I didn't want to do an audio background effect. I just wanted to have it when the lasers are shooting to have this constant laser sound, so I could feel like I'm in an arcade, right? So let's, I don't know if, hopefully you're hearing the audio. Let me check here if people are hearing the audio over here. So now, you see, so when it's shooting now, it's just what I did. Is it's playing two audio effects now, right? When there's a collision, I'm going to play the explosion, right? And when there's this last one I hear, there's simple audio engine. This is how you can just play an effect. Shared engine play effect, one of the two that I preloaded. I can play this laser effect, and if I pass the second argument is true, it'll loop it. That's all that does. So it just keeps playing that beaming sound, that laser sound I called it, as it keeps shooting audio, and that's it. And that's how you can, just 150 lines of code, you can make a simple shooter game, right? Now, I didn't have physics. Like, if you take a look at Gone Bananas, you see it's physics. It's a similar kind of game to that. This one's a little simpler. Shooter games are the easiest to make. So that's kind of why I did that. All right, so let me get back to the slides now. So there's a simple game we made. there's a bunch of other resources we got online. It's all open source, so if you ever have any questions about it, you can dig through the source. Patches are welcome. People want to submit pull requests. You don't have to, though. The source is useful. Just even look at it and learn from. The guys do change it, though. They're pretty nimble and they're pretty responsive. We've got a bunch of samples. I'll put this one up in the samples. I might add a few things to it. Of course, you'll get it through Xamarin University even before I get around to doing that. But a bunch of Cocos samples in a separate repo called CocosSharp samples, including this nice Angry Ninjas game that we had, this port of it. It's an Angry Birds kind of clone. So that's sort of the highest end game I think we have in the samples. We also have a little tutorial I made, very similar to the thing I just went through just now with you. Just has a little more R, it has a few more things, has physics. It has some more stuff. It has physics, has parallax. Those are the two biggest things. It has a little bit more to it than that. Still a simple game. Needed to make something a little less just to get through time here today. It's very similar. So if you want to see physics and you want to see some stuff with parallax as well, and see some other ways to do collision, and also working with animations, sprite sheet based animations, working with sprite batches, it's got a little bit more in it. And I'm going to be making some updates to it here in the near future, add a couple other things. But there's a walkthrough that goes along with it as well. Check out the walkthrough that's in the repo. That's the latest for, that's the most recent one. And the sample code's all there for that. It's also a Windows Phone version of that is too. And we've recently created a new document on our doc site to introduce you to CocosSharp with this little simple Pong-like game. So it walks through all the different steps and builds up this thing. It's not just a walkthrough, though. It does have a little bit more conceptual discussion than what Gone Bananas does, which just jumps in and says, do this, do that. So there's those resources. And then one thing I didn't put in here, there's also our forums. If you go into the Xamarin forums, there's a room for CocosSharp. You can go in there and you ask your questions. And if you don't have, you want to ask questions in there, or if there's anything that we don't get to here in a minute, I'm about to go into the questions, you can ping me, follow me on Twitter, or direct message me on Twitter, or just ping me on Twitter, feel like following me. And that tends to be a good place, I find, to get people because it keeps the messages short. And if you need to, we can always take it to email afterwards. So, feel free to get me afterwards if you or go in the forums. I pop in there now and then.